Hi everyone, so welcome to our podcast.
I've been hijacked. Take over for our second featured artist interview ever here at Brush Point Academy. Our guest for tonight is an alumni of CIIP, a former artist at Synergy 88 with our instructor DJ Lumpia. He is the author and illustrator of the comic You Know You Well, and he likes to introduce himself all the time as an artist that mostly paints nostalgia. So without further ado, welcome Aeonix. Woo!
Woo! Hi everyone. So
sound effects. Hello. Hi. So Aeonix, how are you? Welcome.
I'm very fine actually. I mean, been better. So glad to be here then, and I'd love to talk to I'd love to talk to artists ulit, syempre.
Okay.
Since it's been a while since I actually talked to artists nga pala last Patron of the Arts, so there's that. But it's always nice talking to artists again, you know.
It's the perfect avenue for our subscribers, our very young subscribers. We can start slow, we can start gentle. So we can start with college, okay? You mentioned somewhere before that you took architecture for 1 year. And for my research, you took up MMA and CIIT. Is that correct?
Yes.
Multimedia arts. Okay. So where did you take architecture?
Why only for 1 year?
Yeah.
You know, in the Philippines, when there was a stigma when I took architecture on 2013, since I graduated high school 2013. Okay. I took architecture at Adamson University for a year. And I only took it because we have, you know, Philippine PH, there's a stigma when you take an art course, they said it's better to take architecture because BS in science instead of fine arts or something. There's a stigma like that. So, yeah, I took architecture because of that. But, you know, as much as I learned, I learned something from it, like maybe perspective and measurement and stuff.
Okay.
But I haven't really enjoyed, you know, it's very technical actually.
Yeah.
Personally, I don't think an art background is required for you to take architecture. Like, in our batch, like 40 of us, most of them didn't really draw. Like, they only took architecture because their parents were engineers, architects. And I think around only 3 of us actually draw or paint, like, you know, draw as a hobby. Uh-huh. So most of them don't really draw, you know. And since it's only an advantage or plus if you have an history at drawing when you take architecture, like you're ahead at rendering since you already draw, and you somewhat draw a bit more faster than your friends that didn't really draw before. But I think that's the only cons. And pro, since I don't think people who don't draw doesn't have the same creativity. Like, everyone can be creative naman, even if they don't draw. So, yun, I think that's the only plus, is you draw faster and render a bit more faster than your friends who draw. So, yeah, that's why I took architecture. I mean, I tried to love it, but it didn't really love me.
Oh, I didn't love you back. Okay, is that why the relationship only lasted for 1 year? And then you moved to CIIT.
Yeah, I mean, I really pushed my parents to, I really want to pursue multimedia arts. Like, they were warning me that no regrets, if ever. And yes, I don't have regrets. should I continue my college? There's really a huge difference in committee between an art school and the regular college. Because in CIIT, I found my people. You can be as weird as you want, or be just be you, and no one will don't really mind because they understand, you know, artists can be a bit more different than other people, you know. You get awkward, weird. And it's really fun when you meet the same people like that because, you know, you get to express yourself more, get to connect people more, get better at expressing yourself, not only speech, but also in art. You get to meet same people who almost have the same goal as you, you know. Like, I met people there also. We also draw for fun. We also did the 360-day challenges, you know, and something like that. It's really fun. Like, it's complete 180 from the usual college setting for me.
And after 4 years of CIT, you graduated already. And you said there was no regrets. And I can tell you built up a lot of connections. And I want to ask, like, did you making connections with other people, it started in college through your art, but how did carry over outside of college? How did you find more people to connect?
I think it started when I publicly published art.
Okay.
Like, it started on my personal account, but I had some privacy issues, like privacy concerns. That's why I created a pen name, Ionix, to hide myself from the world. I mean, if you can be interested in my art only, but not my face. But I used to have the mindset like that. So that's why I created an art page so people could follow me in there instead of my personal life, you know.
So you wanted to put attention away from the artist and back into.
Yeah, I really want the people to notice my art, but not really me, for privacy reasons. Since I used to be anxious because of privacy reasons. I mean, way before. I mean, I'm not like that anymore since I already showed my face. But
oh, good for you.
Before. Mm. Mm. And it started there, publishing my artwork publicly. At the first few months, I didn't really have an audience. Like I just posted there and friends of friends saw my art. And gradually, as you put yourself out there, more people will see you, especially if they see your consistency at posting artworks. Like, I used to be consistent posting Philippine settings, and I try to make them as nostalgic as I can. And eventually, more people saw it, and from there, I gained more connection from different artists, even different people. Eventually, I got connected to people who isn't even in the art community, and as well as brands and certain communities. And web space. It's like a spider web. You get one connection, then you get another two, and two.
Okay. Yeah,
something like, it's like a web.
Okay.
From one and spreads like that.
So I wanted to ask about that because from what I can tell, your anxiety, did it happen as an effect of your notoriety with your art that you had issues, that you had to make another account? And did your art help you overcome your anxiety?
I used to have it started when I posted places that are near where I used to live before. And there came a day where people would be like, oh, I know that guy just lives on our same street. He's just our neighbor. And people pointing out exactly where I live, what street I live, and worse is one that even took a picture of our house and posted it on a comment publicly. So it really bothered me for a while. That's why I went completely private on my personal account. So yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry for that.
Oh, thank you.
Subscribers, it's not good to dox people, okay? Don't stop
people. It's not your doing, but thank you.
Okay. But slowly, gradually, I see you've been doing some face reveals again, and even GMA reported it back in
the day. Oh my God.
So,
yeah, I mean, I realized that the more I hid, the more people got curious. Like, I just noticed that the more you hide, the more people will get curious about you. So I just show my face even once in a while. They'll be just, oh, I already saw his face. And it stops there, I think, hopefully.
Okay.
So there.
Thank you for that. Thank you for sharing with that. And I think that's not something a lot of artists are comfortable talking about, like the mental health aspect of art, you know, some of the dangers. Some people would be like, oh, you've got thousands of subscribers, but with that comes some danger, you know? Thank you for that. And hopefully, I mean, I'm glad that you're doing, are you doing better now?
I mean, today, yes, I'm okay today. Okay. There's still some days there, you know,
there are days.
But, you know, we keep on going. So I try not to dwell on it if I'm in a better state, you know. Or if I feel it crippling.
Okay.
Crippling. I try not to get it to me. And hopefully I'm getting a therapy soon too, since I think I needed it.
I'm glad you're getting help, you know. It's never some people are like, there's a stigma for getting help or talking to a therapist, which should not be the case. So I'm really happy that you're getting the help that you need. So there is no shame in that. So subscribers, if you're listening, it's never a bad thing to get help. Speaking of like therapy, but this is art therapy that I'm gonna ask about, because I was stalking that's a bad word, given like everything we've been talking about. I was researching about like some of your old talks before, and you said that you use art as a way to channel, to express yourself. When days come, like when you're really down, when you're like what you mentioned a while ago, crippling, can you still pull yourself to draw, or is there a boundary where you tell yourself, no, I'm not going to draw and it's okay?
I think it's different from people to people. Yeah. I mean, I think it depends then on the weather. Like, personally, I try to push myself to draw, like, and pour everything on an artwork, because it helps. I mean, personally, it helps me express, like, the anxiety, the sadness, and eventually, I mean, when you're painting, you get distracted from those thoughts, and eventually you channel it to your art. I mean, the art can be dark sometimes, but you know, it helps mentally. Like, I think, I'm sorry, what's the question again?
No, it's okay. Like, if it helps you, that does your art help you? Like, is it an outlet when you're...
It's always been an outlet to me. I mean, I'm not sure how it started, but ever since I started painting, it's always been like that. Like, I try to fill myself with a certain emotion, and I pour it out via art.
Okay. It shows, because you have this great ability to not only transport people, you know, when they see your art, into places that exist outside of time. Like, they have this timeless feel to them.
Oh, thank you.
But not only that, I've seen people react. Like, they have strong feelings of loneliness, hope, love, and wonder. So you mentioned somewhere else that you like dialing in more on the mood and lighting and color. Overexpression in an artwork.
So, oh, I mean, I'm sorry. I mean, you mean I like the color mood lighting over the expression of the character?
You like to focus more on the mood lighting and color rather than the expression. Does that still apply today?
Most of the time, yes.
Oh, okay.
I really like moody artworks and with the lighting and everything, more than expressions. You know, I mean, I like to keep it vague, the expression, so it's so open for the interpretation of the observer. Like, I could give him a somewhat listless face, but the mood can be a judge, like maybe it's for nostalgia, he's longing for something, or maybe he's sad, or maybe just bored. I mean, you know, something like that. So I'd like to keep the expression vague, to give space for the observer's interpretation.
So before you do an artwork, is there a certain emotion that you want to highlight? Like, oh, I'm feeling emo today, or I'm feeling so weak, or in English, heartbroken. I'm going to make a so weak face. Do you just wing it? Or do you have some preparations that you do beforehand?
Actually, most of my works, they're more on longing. Longing in the past. Like, maybe it just comes up when I have this habit when I'm outside, like when I'm commuting, I like to take pictures that somewhat feels nostalgic to me, and you know, those, I keep that emotion from the time I take the picture, and I'll draw that picture I painted, I'll draw that picture I took, and I try to paint that and maybe enhance the mood.
Oh, okay. So you have
some... It's because it felt nostalgic to me.
Okay. So those of you that don't know Aeonix, so from what I've been told, like from one time JS and Aeonix were walking and he would just stop and take pictures. So Aeonix really likes taking pictures. That's a good habit for people who want to do illustrations, I can tell.
It's a good practice to practice your fundamentals the same way, same time. It's a good practice for expressing yourself into art. That's when I'm sorry.
No, go on.
That's when you paint something. I mean, you're also like the way I do. I'm also studying it. The perspective and everything. So I'm also expressing at the same time, I'm also learning as I paint.
Okay. Because some of our subscribers here, so as young artists in general, they struggle with extracting that they have an image in their head and they struggle extracting that image and putting it on the canvas. So are there any methods or tips you can share with the people here on how they can efficiently capture that image in their imagination?
Oh, okay. To be honest, the base to improve here is you keep on trying. I mean, you'll never get it on the first try and the second try. You have to do it like 100 times before you get it. Because we're not all visual masters at the first place. Like, I used to struggle as well. Like, I'm not really able. Like, I get those times, like, I get frustrated at putting what's inside my hand in the canvas. But, you know, as you make more of it, you get better at visualizing what's inside your head. And technically, use the fundamentals to get it better. Like, the more you... Personally, the more you know the fundamentals, like anatomy, perspective, proportion, values, the more you'll be able to express what's in your head. Because if ever you don't get an exact pose or exact scene perspective in the first try, you can always adjust it since you you know the fundamentals, you know how to bend the scene to get what exactly as much as possible to get what's inside your head as accurate as possible. Something.
That's great. That's great advice. Yeah.
And the way I do mine, like I always start with, I have lots of process actually. I experimented with a lot, but recently my process has been, I always start with base shapes.
Demo. We have a demo going on, guys.
Yeah. I always start with base shapes. And, you know, after that, I go with the base color. And also, I try to add the lighting. Okay. Let's open the VSD later. Then after that, I go more on details like that. And you know how I make these bottles? I just painted one and duplicated them. I mean, it's always legal. You need to conserve your energy as well. I mean, I always, you can always draw smart. I mean, you don't have to work hard always, but you can always draw smart to conserve your energy. And as well, you should take care of your hands. So yeah, and actually here, I just recycled an old artwork. You can always recycle your old artworks. I mean, the assets. That's why I always separate. I'll show a better view of it later. But you know, let's open it. Where is it?
You hear that, subscribers? Work smart, not hard.
Yeah.
Work smart.
Okay here. Okay, so here's the line art. It's very simple, actually. Just get the base perspective and the big blocks of shapes of how you want your artwork to look. And after that, here's the base art. So here's the base color. The background used to look like this. So yeah, I recycled an old asset from an old artwork, because why not? I mean, it's still my work, so I could always reuse it, but just make sure to match it from the current perspective. Like the perspective I have here is somewhat going here, so doesn't have to be perfect, but you try to make it as believable as possible, so it looks believable, you know.
Is that perspective you're talking about?
Yes. In architecture term, yes, perspective. How do you know that?
Oh, I did my research about you.
Yes, it's perspective. But you know, it works. It somewhat works. So here's the character. I don't always draw the sides where, you know, it gets covered anyway, so why work hard on that?
Conserve energy, right?
Yes. Nice. So, you know, And here's the character. And here's more of that. I adjust it via levels and add more color burn. You can always check your drawing prepared in black and white to check your values.
Okay.
I always have that ready. And add more rim light, maybe. This is more of personal taste. I like my drawing that is somewhat glow, has this inner glow. I mean, it looks bad right now, but because when I was painting it, I had this on, so I was trying to get the mood feel that is right, that feels right to me.
Okay.
So, yeah, and here's the effects more, you know, the bloom from the light. You could always add that later on. You know, I painted this because I always wanted to, you know, when there's moments when I'm opening, when a friend is opening a fridge of 7-Eleven, I always like the scene where, you know, you could also see the reflection of the other things around because of the reflection. At the same time, the character still looks seen.
Okay.
So the final art is this. I use layer modes to adjust the colors. And I also use this mode a lot. I use selective color. You could always try this to have a more, let's say, okay, you can try this. So let's say I want to adjust the red only. We could adjust the red to more warm. We could even adjust its lightness or darkness. And only the red color gets touched. And it's a great tool to play with the mood. And, you know, when I add red, the whites in the drawing, you could always just want a cool tone, more warm tone, more yellow or magenta. It's up to you, really. I mean, using this tool, I came up with this. And using curves, I adjusted the values again. And lastly, I crop it a bit because I feel like the composition is better here.
Okay.
Then I added noise for the photo effect and chromatic aberration. I mean, would you guys like to know how I make the chromatic aberration?
Oh, I think they would enjoy that. Yeah, quick demo.
So let's say this is a final artwork. I duplicate it and I duplicate it again and double click on that. And you see these channels, you click on red or blue, whatever or whichever you like. And from there, you just click the move tool. Then you slightly move the drawing. And there, see, you can see there. Just don't do it. I suggest not doing it too much because it's quite strenuous in the eyes. So I just do it a little bit like that, if you can see.
Are you using your arrow keys?
Yes, I'm using the arrow keys here. Oh, okay. So yeah, you can see. I mean, can you see the red outline? Yeah.
Yeah, I see it.
Yeah, it adds a somewhat photographic effect. Also, it helps you, let's say you want to take the focus here. It helps to defocus things. Like let's say I want to not focus the stuff. I want to lose the focus the stuff. To lose focus on the stuff here, I want to focus only on the face. So I'll add some chromatic aberration and using the mask tool, I'll just erase the chromatic aberration on the face because I want that to be more on focus. So it brings back the focus on the face because everything else is like chromatically aberrated. I don't know if that's a real word, but you know, it takes away the attention here and focus more here because it doesn't have that chromatic aberration thingy. So when you turn it on and off, there's an effect. And lastly, add noise, you know, for the mood.
Oh, okay. Those are some Aeonix hacks right there, subscribers. Very juicy. Very juicy.
So,
thank you.
So is that. So yeah, we have that.
All right. So we have that. And thank you for sharing, by the way. So
you're welcome. I hope you guys will able to use that.
Well, I'm sure they will.
Oh, yes.
Now, let's have a idea. Let's have a situation. Let's say some of our subscribers, or maybe like anyone in general, like, it's a situation where they try to capture what they have in their head. They try to express themselves using the tricks that you've taught, and then when they make their artwork, you mentioned before that some of the younger artists become frustrated when their numbers aren't that high. And I'm gonna quote you here. You mentioned you said that unahin mo muna i-please ang sarili mo. Aeonix 2020. So in English, that means you should first please yourself. When doing an artwork, you know, when you're posting artwork online, you should first please yourself. And that came from me. That was your advice. You know, if you're not satisfied with your artwork, with yourself, how will you help please other people with the art, right?
Yes, I still stand by that.
Very good. All right. Now my question is, how do you please yourself? No, wait, let me rephrase that. That sounds wrong.
Yeah, that sounds wrong.
That sounded better in words. No. How do you motivate yourself? You know, what are the milestones that have helped you to keep moving forward with your art, with yourself?
Oh, I think this will always fall back to what your core is as an artist. Like, why do you draw? Like, what do you like? What do you like to draw the most? Because personally, when I feel demotivated, like sometimes I forget the feeling of joy in painting. I will try to get back at what I love painting most, which is I love painting Philippine backgrounds that has nostalgic feeling in them to me. And you could always, you could try that too. Like, what do you love drawing as a kid? Like, you know, we all had that kid inside. Maybe you like drawing flowers, skies, anything you like, robots. Try getting back to what made you draw in the first place. And, you know, it helps to remind you that you always have yourself at drawing. Like, you don't need anyone else's approval or praise, because you always have yourself. Like, you always have your core. And that, I mean, you could always try to review those, like, what's your core at drawing, what do you love drawing the most, and what subject makes you feel satisfied you finish it. Makes you feel after painting that you feel finally.
Oh, there you have it. Aeonix's prescription home remedy for those tough times with your art.
It's honestly because it's the art industry is really fast moving, you know. Most of us gets pressured of the fast moving industry. Like, we need to keep up always with the big artists and the trends and everything. You know, it's very burning. Forgot the word. It's very frustrating, especially when you get to the burnout phase of it. Like, you know, we should always try to take a break when we can, and be nicer to ourselves, you know, and get back to reflect what made us paint in the first place, you know.
Go on.
You know, reflecting on life, you know, it helps, because, you know, when we do that, we somehow know which step we should take next, which things we should focus about, and which ones should we really prioritize, you know. And it helps us feel better in ourselves, you know. Because you know yourself better when you reflect a lot.
Oh, that's great, because some of our subscribers, whenever we hang out in the lounge, they wanted me to ask you, like, how does Aeonix keep himself from stagnating, especially because he's a freelance artist, you know. Everything's fast-paced, and they wanted to hear it from you because they really look up to you. So thank you for sharing your home remedy. There you have it.
Thank you.
There you go. And speaking of things that you love doing, you've mentioned before that you really love showcasing the beauty of the Philippines, and you tend to paint places you've been to, and I don't think you have drawn places that you haven't been to yet. Is that still correct? Okay.
Yes.
Is there like a connection to that? Because you haven't built a connection. Like, if you haven't set foot in a place, there's no connection. There's no nostalgia yet for you.
Yeah, no. I can't express that place well when I have been there personally. Because I don't feel it like a drawing might look soulless to me. If I do that, like, I don't feel this drawing at all, you know, it doesn't feel like me.
Like, you can't capture it.
Yeah,
you
can't capture. Yeah, I can't do it. Unless I'm doing it for a commission.
Oh, okay. That's different.
That's a different subject now.
Yeah, it's different. Because money is involved in that one.
Right. Yes.
So, like you mentioned earlier, you take your own pictures and you paint over them. You know, that helps with fundamentals and you capture... You're directly referencing from real life.
Somewhat. Yes. Yes,
somewhat. It's still related to that. You know, I have a spicy question.
90? I'm sorry, yes.
Yeah, for certain poses, do you still do the same? Do you take pictures that you paint over, like for reference? Like, for example, you have some pics here of a girl with a hand on a guy's chest and it's the POV of a girl. Do you get someone to do that and then you take a picture and then you paint over it? And there I see some kissing scenes here. Like, do you like hire models or do you reference that online? You know, there are some poses here. Like, I know like JS told us to take pictures of ourselves for references. I just wanted to know, do you do the same for some of your artworks here?
For the poses?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I still do it a lot. Like, since the great, you could always use references because you can't paint what you don't know, so it's always okay to use references, like different angles of your hands or even yourself. You could always use that. I mean, there's no wrong with using references.
So how about like for some of the pics here of like your main OC, your male character, with a girl's hand on his cheek, how did you reference that? Did you get someone's hand?
Yes.
Nice.
But not really my girlfriend. I mean, I asked my sister that time.
Oh, okay.
Like, oh, put your hands on my face. I need to draw something. I need a reference. And yeah, they're very supportive, by the way.
So, oh, that's nice. That's great. There you have it, subscribers. There are some poses that are really hard to find references.
Yes, especially it's very hard. I mean, could always, while doing references, you also learn from that. Like, you'll gradually learn better at painting proportions because you have a real reference at by side, and gradually you learn to break those reference, like you learn to stylize them a bit, like whatever you want. Like, you know, maybe you in the reference the finger you want isn't exactly what you like, but since you draw a lot hands than before, you could break that finger a bit, something bit more like, you know, or even change the whole lighting or setting.
Do you have some works you can show how you did that? Like, for example, fingers or hands. Okay. Or an artwork, yeah.
I'll say, wait.
If you have the reference photo that you took, so our subscribers can see how the Master Aeonix does it. Because some people, they're too afraid to take pictures of themselves. They become a slave to the internet for references. If they can't find that reference, they get frustrated. So.
Okay. Wait, I'll find something here. Wait, could I off my screen for a while? Because I have some.
NDAs, sure, no problem.
wait, actually, but wait, just a real quick. Wait, I'll look on something.
Well, Aeonix is doing
that. I'll open my Facebook as well because I used to send my references on myself, you know.
Oh, okay, yeah. If you didn't know the subscribers,
I send it on my
to yourself.
I send it on my on my old Messenger because, you know, I take pictures directly to my Messenger and, you know, copy paste that and. Use that as reference myself, but you know I have some. I also sent some, you know, other more personal reference there. So
okay, no problem. So behind the curtain. So I hope our subscribers are all buzzed up. If you have any questions you would like to ask Aeonix, please have them ready, and I will let you know when we're gonna open the Q&A portion. Oh, I see some excited people. All right. So I hope you guys took note of some of those tips that he's been giving. Because I know some of you guys, when we hang out, you often ask like JS or DJ Lumpia,
about certain things. And we have Aeonix here about to demonstrate how we apply it. It's like that.
Okay. Wait. Oh, where's my other reference? I'll also take some very old pictures.
From behind the scenes here. Never before seen elsewhere, am I right? I didn't see this on YouTube.
Oh, yes, because I don't really record my process a lot since I'm not comfortable at, I'm not comfortable when people are watching me.
Yeah, no worries about that.
Right.
Some juicy stuff, some juicy secrets right here, subscribers.
They're not really secrets naman, you know. When you have a reference naman, it's always good to have them.
Some of them, like I'm gonna spill some beans. Like we were hanging out last night, and some of them were really excited to have your talk right now. So some of them, like,
when you meet me, when you personally meet me, naman, I always share my process, like how I do it. Mm-hmm. Oh my god, no, not my references. Wait, I hate my face here. Wait. But yes, I do it a lot. Wait. I'll just paint over my face.
You can draw a smiley face like with Mr. Bean.
Wait.
How are we doing, subscribers?
So okay, I always share how I do it since it's always nice to share techniques, you know, because in the end, they'll be able to use those techniques as well, you know, to do other things, like not exactly what you're doing, but, you know, it could always help another artist doing something, you know, to see, you know, even better if they can even utilize what you shared and even improve that.
Okay. Oh, we got a quickie question while you're censoring your face right now.
Yes.
From Konichi. Hello, I'd like to ask if you have other topics that you would like to make art of, aside from the topics and genre that you usually tackle. So I'm guessing, aside from nostalgic pieces, I think she's asking, is there another genre you wanna do, like maybe horror, psychological?
Oh, recently I'm more on siguro more on artworks that drive from my negative emotions, because I have a lot of them recently. But you know, I had those artworks where, you know, it's a bit surreal, on the surreal side, like maybe a few hands, like multiple hands choking a human, you know.
Oh, the red one.
It felt like drowning, you know. I mean, I did try to, but also I haven't had the enough motivation to paint something so detailed again.
It's your way of overcoming those, like exposing those negative emotions. Is that your way of letting them go or like putting them away?
Yeah, yes.
There we have it. Art therapy. Self-expressiveness.
Oh, wait. I can't find my references. Wait.
No worries.
So while I'm still looking for it, you could still ask.
Okay. On the topic of that, I guess, can you talk about like the artwork that was the heaviest emotionally for you to do as of now? I mean, which one really took out a lot of you
to do? Negative or positive?
Any. I mean, emotionally, as long as it was charged, you know, there's a lot of emotions invested into that artwork, be it good or bad.
I think the recent one, you know, the one in the bed.
Okay. How come?
It's a bit personal, but okay. You know.
Whatever you're comfortable talking about. You know,
sometimes when we beg people too much to stay when we're having attacks, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It feels so bad that you get left behind. But, you know, we don't put too much big expectations on people. Because in that time, I thought I couldn't do it alone, but then I'm still okay.
Okay. Hmm. Interesting.
And I think the positive one, I think it's still the comm shop. The comm shop artwork.
Oh, from a while back.
Ah, yes. Because, okay. You know, when I was painting that, I really love, I was really pouring the nostalgia on that. Okay.
All right. Thank you for sharing those two artworks. You can find them in Leonix's Instagram. So if you're interested, we'll look at those. Yeah, you ready?
Wait. I'm compiling everything as much as I can in the PSD. I'm compiling at the same time. I try to overpaint my face. Because, you know.
You're trying to merge it in case. Yeah. There's no way they can see it. No face reveal. Even Aeonix's real name has been redacted, like, by the FBI. You never find out.
Wait, I'll just cover it as much as I can. Wait, but to get the basic idea of using references into drawing. Where's the drawing though?
It's gonna be great for some of our subscribers here that are starting out, because some of them background, some of them are still students, some of them are working, but they're not working in art, but they want to make that leap into art when they're grinding their way.
Okay,
so we have a lot of mixed backgrounds here.
Okay. I mean, I'm glad to hear that then. I mean, artists could really come from different backgrounds. You know Justin Cruz, na, di ba? Sir Justin Cruz. He was a nurse.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, I know he was a nurse, but now he's an art director.
Yep. So far. It still holds up today. He was in our server. I think it was yesterday. Yeah, he was here as well. Yeah.
Okay.
He was having
and here. Okay. Wait. I even make I'll explain it later.
No pressure.
No, there is pressure.
Oh, it's a safe space here.
I mean, just a personal pressure, not from you guys. I'm sorry.
Okay.
It's not pressure from you guys, but, you know, personal pressure.
It's all good. As the Gen Z kids would say, it's all Gucci. All right. I got a question, though, on the topic of nostalgia. Because, like you said, you like to paint nostalgia. Mm-hmm. And I went and researched the etymology of nostalgia. Etymology, subscribers, means like the origin of the words.
Nostos and...
Yes. Yeah.
And...
Algos.
Algos, right?
Yep. Nostos means return home, and then algos means pain in Greek. So, you can say it's acute homesickness or homesickness. So, when you feel nostalgic, you have this longing for home. Mm-hmm. And I searched the definition from a dictionary. Nostalgia means a wistful desire to return in thought or in fact, maybe in person, physically, to a former time in one's life, to one's home or homeland, or to one's family and friends. A sentimental yearning for the happiness of a former place or time. That is the definition of nostalgia.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I can tell you have a deep love for the Philippines because the Philippines is our home. And you've mentioned you want to showcase the beauty of our country through your art. In my research, you cited your Lola as one of the reasons why you love painting nostalgic places. Did you grow up with your Lola? Has she impacted your love for nostalgic places?
I think when I was a toddler, I used to hang out with my grandma to the point that I even love hanging out with her more than with my family. You know, I was a Lola's boy.
Oh, same. Yeah.
But you know, wait lang. Here's the perfect. Oh my. Wait lang. I just found a pun. Wait lang. No, references. Yeah. These references are so funny. Wait. So yeah, you know, my lola before used to, take me to places a lot, like places I didn't even know before, but I strangely remembered them visually. And so visiting them as an adult, like, oh, I know this place, lola takes me here before. So yeah, that's the nostalgia, because my lola goes around a lot when I was a kid. Like, she would visit many places, palenques, markets, things like that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, that somewhat stuck with me.
Uh-huh.
So yeah,
and it goes back to your childhood again, you know, mm-hmm. a time with your lola.
Yes. Okay. So yeah, that's why it's, I think that's where it all came from. Like, it's really, I think the impact of childhood really speaks a lot with how we will see life as an adult.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, I think it really stems from our childhood. Wait, I'm sorry, it's taking a while. I'm really compiling a lot, you know, at the same time. Oh, okay, here we go. Okay.
Sounds like the demo is going to be another juicy one.
I'm glad to share. You know, I'm really lazy at painting, you know, so I always look for ways to paint faster, you know. And I've learned a lot through the years. I've learned a lot. I think this is enough naman na for now.
Yeah, no worries. This have to be like 50 examples.
I'm sorry. Okay.
It's okay. No worries. Oh, we got some subscribers redeeming with questions. Hang on, guys.
Okay,
We will get to those in a bit.
Share my screen now. Okay, screen one. Go like. Okay, can you see my screen?
Do not judge
me. But
oh, there we go. Okay.
So in the first one, okay, here. I'm trying to paint a complicated hand here. So, uh-huh. You know, I always take pictures like this. You know, it doesn't have to be so good, but, you know, it gets the idea there. Okay. I use here to paint the hand here. You know, that's a few examples of especially hands. And here we have, here. I even made a paper pinwheel for this, you know. Doesn't have to be the exact like that, but, you know, gets the mood or idea of how I want it to look like, you know, especially the folds on the hoodie. It doesn't have to look exactly as it, but you know, you visualize it better when you really have a reference.
Okay.
So yeah, it's another example. And here's a classic one here. I painted this on 2017. I know I have a reference on this, but I can't really find it on. I have a reference for the folds, and oh, here, okay. No, perfect. I don't have reference for this. So you know, you could really see the differences between with no reference and with reference. You know, reference is good, but no, no, it's missing a few something right there.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm criticizing my own art. No, I could get better like that. You know, yeah, that's the difference within, you know, with references and without reference, with references and without references.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the reference, you know, here. It's really how I do it is, so So let's say let's remake this quick, real quick, how I turn this into this, you know.
Okay.
So let's say, okay, we have this, right? All right. So yeah, we have that. And there's a tip: if you don't know where the perspective is inside the picture, you can always try to review its perspective, like where the line falls, like follow this, when you can find the horizon line, you could always find where the vanishing point is by where it first connects here. So it's mostly here. So this is the horizon line. So if you finally got that on your drawing, you could take that, take it here, and you create your, this is your vanishing point, and you could use that as your guide. This is when you, if you want to be, you want a quick guide for perspective, and from there, since you already had your guide, always, you could always now draw anything from the drawing. Like, you, there's a wall here, you could see that there's a point here, and there, down on here, you can slightly see the upper side of this wall, because it's below the horizon line, so you can see what's above it, you know. Oh wait, you could just use one guide and visually point that, and here's something here and something here, and just this point here, this is the corner, the L corner here, here, and for things like this, you could always just connect it. Yeah, it just follows the those. Yeah, and here's the stairs, and yeah, and there you have it. See, when you have this basic look of for the big block shape, you could just paint the details after. So there's a phone lines here. There's two phone lines there, and there, that's the base drawing. And from there, you start with the details now, like you start with the let's say the cream color here. You could color pick, and you could, you know, paint from there. And as you paint, you could add, when it doesn't feel good to you, you could always play with your own. There, I'd like it to be more orange or more yellow. There. And yeah, that's it. You know, when you have reference, it's always fun when you paint side by side while you look at the reference and try to mimic what you see. At the same time, you're also learning, like, the how the material works, the shine. Don't have to copy it exactly, you know, but you're still learning. And also, I think I have a signature now. No, I don't have a signature there. I don't know where I put the Yonix there.
The Easter egg somewhere.
But yeah, you know, also I don't like to detail everything, especially the one in the back. If you can see here, you know, the windows here are just painted like that. Because it's not really the focus of the drawing, you know. Unless that's your intention, you could always detail them if you like, you know. And even the people didn't have heights here because they're not the focus.
Do you use 3D in your workflow?
When I work? I don't know how to use 3D.
Okay.
Though I'm planning to learn Blender, you know, because it helps.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh. So, yeah, from there, we also have... This is a funny one. Oh, my God.
Oh, that's how you did it.
Oh, my God, no. Not this balloon thingy. You know, I'm having an anxiety attack that time, but at the same time, it looks funny when I take the picture like this. And I even have other pictures of this.
Oh, that's so cool. Okay.
You know, it helps. Whatever helps, you know, whatever helps your drawing. I even try to mimic the lighting.
Cool. So, did you set up the lighting yourself?
Yes.
Oh, that's cool.
You know, it's also having having to study. It's also helps with lighting study, like, you know, how forms develop in lighting, you know, like here. If the lighting comes from below, you know, the form of the anatomy, like here, and the shadow, how it, the shadow, and especially the fingers. So, yeah. Oh my God! No!
Face reveal!
Oh my God,
no. No screenshots, please.
No,
no, oh no.
Anyway.
All right. Thank you for those short demos, guys.
I
hope you were able to take note of some of those hacks. Because some of these people were asking, like, how do you conceptualize? How do you start? Do you paint from, like, do you paint everything or do you paint over? So I hope that answered these questions.
I paint everything, actually.
Yeah, there we go.
All and right. Siguro ang the only thing I don't paint is maybe textures. Or maybe like I have some artworks where I have the LRT map on them. As long they're not copyrighted, you could use them as assets.
Royalty free assets. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Got it. Okay, that was a juicy. So,
oh my god, my FB.
Oh. Oh no, no one saw anything.
Let me off the stream. I forgot to turn off my FB. Oh my god. But you know, wait. I hope you didn't see my name.
This is too fast. I didn't see anything. I don't know about subscribers. I trust that they didn't see anything. They were too focused on the art. It's all good.
Oh, thank you. But you know, wait. Yeah. I'll share more. Since we're here, yes. I'll share. Wait. I'll share. I'll share everything I know. I mean this. These are just techniques, so you could always use them for your own advantage, you know, because drawing isn't really easy, so why not share what you know, diba? Because then we all have different ideas, so I'm sure you know, when sharing texts, I'm sure people won't copy your work for that. So why not share them? Because they're just techniques, ganun.
Yeah. In music, some people keep asking, like, oh, what gear did you use? What strings? What are your pedals? Like they want to really be exactly like their idols. Like, they have the same gear and everything. But they still won't sound the same because it comes from you, how they play the music. I think that applies with art. You can have
artist's
brushes and all the hacks. But
yeah, but in the end, it's still... how you would like to express it.
Yeah. These are just tools at the end of the day.
Oh, yes, exactly. These are just tools.
Yeah. I was going to ask because some people struggle with, like, they have the idea, but in Tagalog, nabibitin sila, or like with their own skills, like they can't get the idea fast enough on paper. They end up noodling on the fingers if it's perfect. That they spent 30 minutes to 1 hour on just the hands, and then they haven't even done the whole face yet, and then they see that everything's out of proportion. So what you're sharing right now would help some of the subscribers be more efficient. And
Of course. And in the end, you try to make it as believable lang as possible, and but not everything too detailed, you know. I'll share it here then. Is it here, ba? Wait. Oh, is my screen on, ba? No.
Not yet.
Okay. Oof. So I'll share this one and a few tips.
While that is happening. Oh, you've not been here. Disconnected. Oh, there we go. I see it. Escape plan.
So this one, yun nga siya. So this is the sketch. So basically, nouna, at first, I didn't really have like buildings. I only drew the big shapes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized I have lots of building assets that I saved Yes, I recycled them. So you can see them. You can see them here. Because, you know, it's really hard painting buildings. It's even this one. These are just one aircon that I duplicated it. So yeah, these are just one aircon. You know, I duplicated it and changed the sides in here.
Okay.
And I even just duplicated it on below. It's just I just overpainted the one on the top, and the buildings at the back are actually, everything here is. That's why you should always save your assets like on separate layers, because you never know when you can use them. Like here, it's very, they're all separate assets, and you could always reuse these assets on different settings and even change the lighting. In here, I use this same exact assets of buildings in this same artwork.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I change it into nighttime, but there's still the same asset.
If you never told me, I wouldn't have thought that you reused the assets. So
yeah, you know, but you always change that. But you know, wait, yeah, I just flip it, but it's no the same asset. No one would know. How would they know?
Unless you tell them. Sneaky. Yes, all right.
You know, it's your art. You could always work smart. Yeah, here it's the same asset, but I just changed the mood. See, and you could with the layer separated of each building, you could always move them around to change them a bit. Mm-hmm. You know. So that's the advantage of, you know, saving your or preserving your layers, you know.
Someone asks, do you have an easy and quick way to change the lighting mood of the environment that you use? For example,
I do.
Go.
Oh wait. Yeah, do you guys want me to show you like, let's say, sunrise setting into a rainy setting?
Oh, they said yes, please.
Ah, wait lang. I look for S's. Wait lang. I look for that asset. Wait.
Go on.
But I know I have a PSD ready for that.
While you're looking for some, can we answer some of the questions?
Sure. What's the questions?
Some of the subscribers are piling in. So one asks, how do you take in criticisms that are given about your work? Do you take them all, or do you filter them and only apply the ones that you think made the most sense for you?
Yes, I mean, there will always be people who will have critics on your work, but you also have the choice to pick your critics, like always pick your apple, like pick what works for you and pick that don't. Because if you stress over yung things that, because you can control those people na who will comment about your, because there will always be people who will comment about your art. So pick the ones that will help you, and don't pick those that will only make you feel bad.
There we have it. Another one asks, Mr. JC asks, you have a very distinct art style that when people see your artwork, it's like, oh, it's Aeonix. So he's asking, like, what's your not so Aeonix artwork and art style, and how do you face it? Do you have struggles in doing a different art style that you're not used to?
I think I had that problem when I used to work on a game studio. I mean, JS will know. JS and Ella. I mean, they know. Inspector Ella. Because I used to work with them before, and I used to have problems. Like, because you have to follow a client's art style, you know.
So, like, adapting to another.
Yes, art style. You have to learn how to adapt and bend your art style. But you know, I have that problem, right? But I did try. Like, I did have a few works before.
Personally, yeah.
Yeah, personally, like I tried to stray away from what I usually do. Like a break.
Uh huh.
Oh wait, I can't find that
one. I see some manga inspired artwork. Yeah.
Excited too. Like, it's fun to explore other styles once in a while because you also learn that way. You also learn something from it. Wait, I can't find that PSD.
No worries. Let's move on to the next few ones. Do you have any dream project that could be personal or maybe professional for a studio?
Oh,
or,
yes. I wanna finish my manga. That's all. Oh, I don't.
You have a manga. Is this Know You Well or is it something else?
Yes, the Know You Well.
Oh, it's ongoing. There you have it.
Yeah, I made the story back when I was college and I remade the whole story because, you know, people change. And you know, it was very cringy for me now because, you know, I wrote that when I was 18. I'm 28. I'm almost 28 now. So, yeah.
So it's the feelings aren't the same anymore.
Some people change. But you know, I have a different vision about things. Right, things nowadays. Like, I also outgrew the mindset I used to have before.
Okay, because from my research, if correct me if I'm wrong, but like Bella, I think she was someone from your past in high school. Things didn't work out with her.
No. she's fictional.
She's fictional. She doesn't exist anymore. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I guess she is partly inspired from people, but her whole look is actually fictional. But maybe the personality is somewhat inspired. But you know, she's a fictional character.
Okay. No worries about that. It's only normal for people to change. Musicians don't always play the same, make the same music. I think that same goes for artists. I think they're allowed to expand. I think this next question, it's perfect for the demo for how you change the background. Because she's asking, what's your biggest tip when painting sunset settings and buildings? I think you can also show that later while you're demoing how to change the environment, the lighting with rain and stuff.
Okay. I mean, I can't find this. Oh no.
No worries. We got a lot of questions from these subscribers. They're teeming with energy to ask you.
Well, I'm glad you guys are asking, Ren, because you know, I have a feeling that, I mean, it's nice that people are curious, because it's always nice to share, you know, what you know to people, especially if it's somewhat technical or someone you know.
They look up to you. A lot of them look up to you. Maybe like the demo could be like one environment, but you're changing the lighting like day, night, like different scenarios. Just so it's not like heavy on you, because you might have a lot of files to sift through. So maybe that'll help. I got a question. That's good. Let's get very personal while we're waiting for the file. So some people attribute their sense of home, not necessarily to physical places, you know.
Mm-hmm. A person.
Yeah, I was about to say that. So some could be like a person or a place. That does not have to be a place. It can be a feeling or a person. So are these artworks, when you paint nostalgia, are they your way of saying that you are still looking for home? You know, are you still in search? Because remember when you said earlier that to be nostalgic is to be to have went somewhere and then miss it, you know. So whenever you paint nostalgia, there's a binary connection. Like, you can't have that nostalgic feeling without the sense of loss. So are you still looking for home?
I'm not exactly looking, but more on I'm longing for the time that is already gone.
Mm-hmm.
You know, since that is also the past.
Uh-huh. You're longing for that. So
yeah, I mean, I still long for the past once in a while, because you know, the past, there's lots of good times from the past.
Okay, that's great. And there's nothing wrong with that, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. There's nothing wrong with being nostalgic for the past.
I mean, it's a personal preference, you know, so
I got a question. So, when Aeonix was first known, you were already doing nostalgia, I believe. So I have a question. If you were to move beyond the nostalgia, if you were to stop longing, for example, for the past, would you still be Aeonix or would you still be painting? Because I know you mentioned earlier, like you're like do for your home remedy, you do stuff that you that makes you happy. And this is the complicated binary that I'm very fascinated about from the interviews I've seen. You love drawing the past, even though you're genuinely happy, but also you like that feeling of nostalgia. If you were to not be nostalgic, would you still be able to paint Aeonix, you know?
Oh, I mean, I'm still Aeonix. I mean, that wouldn't change anything from I draw.
Oh, okay. Uh-oh. You're not super tied to that. Okay. Some people are like, it's the only thing I can draw. Like, this is the only thing I must draw because I won't be myself anymore. Okay.
I thought you said if I draw other things other from nostalgic stuff, would I still be Aeonix? You know, is that the question you're asking?
Yeah, like, is it really tied to your identity as Aeonix?
Not really. I mean, I'm Aeonix as me. I mean, doesn't have to be tied to be with a single genre only.
Nice.
I mean, I must, you know, it's everyone is a spectrum of, every artist is a spectrum of different things and not just one thing.
Oh, that's a nice quote. Everyone's a spectrum of different things. Aeonix 2024.
I mean, people are very complicated beings. So, you know, you can't just define them in one art style or one mood. We all have... Oh, yes, I found it! Sorry. I'm sorry. I got excited. I found it. I finally found it, the perfect file.
No worries. And I'm sure subscribers are very excited.
Wait. Let me see. Oh no, the layers are not preserved. Wait. I look for a way. No, this is a challenge. Since it's a rainy one, I prefer changing a sunset to rainy because that's easier. So the challenge here is changing from raining to sunny. So that's a challenge here. Oh my god. Oh no, wait.
Can be rainy and sunny at the same time. Matik balance getting married.
Oh no, this is gonna be, wait, did I not really have, oh my god, no, wait.
Oh, some are asking. They're really excited to see the different times of day for a painting. They've been asking, like, can you show daytime to nighttime, rainy to sunset?
oh no, okay, wait. No.
If you guys have any more questions you want to ask Aeonix, you can put them here on the side.
Wait, no. Why are the layers not preserved? Wait, are this the file? No. I can't find the layers.
Oh, someone's asking, do you have any favorite artists? That's a hardcore. I mean, that's a common question.
Yes, I have many favorite. Of course, one of them is Makoto Shinkai, and of course, one of the core artists that really inspired me to paint backgrounds is Penguin Frontier. Mm. If you see his artwork, I mean, I was really amused how he paints background. Like, they look so detailed first time you see them, and then when you zoom in, wow. They're all simplified. Like, most of them are simplified into smaller details that are believable enough. You know, I mean, it's not detailed as exact is, but it is believable. So that's, and that time I was thinking, if he could do that, then I can do it too. You know, I have that mindset. So that mindset kind of helps me improve in my art.
Oh, well, that's great. He can do it, so can I. Oh, okay.
I have a strong motivation. Maybe it's the teen genes. I mean, we used to have lots of motivation as young artists. You know, we're all hungry for learning. when life doesn't hit you that hard yet.
Well, that's a great thing to have, because some artists, they have the opposite. They get discouraged. Aww. Like, wow, like, I mean, great that he can do that, but like, it's a big mountain I have to climb. They don't see that, oh, someone was able to climb that mountain. I think they're able to do that.
Oh, I mean,
it's time for me on next, I guess
everyone copes differently, ganun. But yun, if you could fight the, you know, you could fight the noises in our head that demotivates us, because they're just noises. Try to fight them as much as you can. Punch them. Wait. I'm still trying to figure out how I'm gonna make this work, because I honestly don't know anymore.
It's all good.
Wait, but I'll make sure to share it. Wait. I'm still looking. Just don't know how will this ever work. From rain to sun. I'm honestly, this isn't part of my plan today, but here we are.
Surprise!
It is what it is.
What would be easier for, like, would it be easier for you to share your screen while you're problem solving, or would you prefer to solve it first and then show us?
I'm still looking for the PSD.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I already found the PSD, but the one that doesn't have its layer preserve, and it's also the one that's preserved is the rainy scene and not the sunny scene. So yeah, that's my dilemma right now. But you know,
by layer preserve, do you mean that they're merged?
I can't find the yes, no, the layers are preserved, but you know, the I have the version where there's no lighting, like there's only plain lighting.
Oh, okay. So do you have multiple versions of artworks?
Yes.
You save multiple files. Oh, okay. That's interesting.
Because, you know, you never know when you could reuse them.
Also, the file isn't too big, because some people keep them all in one file.
Oh, yes, parang it's different for each file.
Uh-huh.
No, how do I wait? Where are you?
Do you have some art book you could recommend some of the artists here? Some art books that you're really fond of.
Some artwork that I'm really fond
of. Oh. Art books.
Actually, I'm really fond of Shinkai Makoto art books.
Oh, okay.
I guess we have no choice. We have no choice, guys. We have to do this the hard way. But I am ready. I guess I am ready. I mean, I don't have a choice, but you know.
We're gonna see how he problem solves this.
Yes, problem solve with me, because I am hopeless right now. I mean, not hopeless, but you know, I can find the file, because this is taking so much time already. I hope you're not bored.
Are you guys bored? I don't think they're bored. I think they were jump scared a while ago. Oh, see, they're flooding right now. Nope, not bored at all. There we go.
Okay, so here's the file artwork of the rain, and this is the one I'm looking for, the sunset, because this one is easier to translate into a rainy one than a rainy one to a sunset. Personally, it's very hard. But you know, we'll find a way. So here's the rainy scene. Here's everything here. So yeah, here's the rainy scene. And here's the final scene of the rain. So I think we'll turn this into sunset, right?
We can start with that, yeah. We can start with sunset.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sunset. Okay, let's do it. Let's do this quick. Okay. And we'll use this as our reference, but we don't have to copy it as accurate as possible, because we don't have the time. Do we?
Oh, it's up to you. I think our subscribers would like to stay more.
Okay.
I'm here all night.
let's delete this. Delete. I mean, I'm not saving this. So let's delete all this. Delete. So I think first, but it's a good thing I got the main background separated. So I guess the first thing we'll do is we'll paint the sky. So we got a blue here and an orange. So let's paint. Get this color here and take this color here, but we're not gonna copy the sunset here. We'll make the sunset come from the other side. Let's do that.
All right, is this your favorite time of the day? 5 o'clock, am I correct?
Yes,
golden hour. All right,
so here we'll make the sunset come from this, from the left side. It comes from the right side here, so we'll make it on the left side. So we're gonna have some strong rim light here instead. So yeah, we'll make that. So now that we have the base sky, let's paint the cloud. I love clouds. Yes, I love clouds. Okay, let's make a big blob first. Let's take the cloud here. Let's paint some delicious clouds.
Happy clouds.
Yes, happy clouds. Doesn't have to be detailed. Let's take some color here. Okay. And take some color here. And let's make it from the other side. I start with the sky because the whole lighting will really depend on the sky.
Okay.
Since it's we're trying to achieve the global illumination of the sky, it acts like a huge reflector. So most of the lighting color here will really depend on the sky.
Okay.
So let's paint that. And I also love the glow of the clouds. When the sky hits them, it just really glows so beautiful. Okay, let's paint that something redder, I think. I'm just trying to get the mood for now, and we'll render that later.
Yeah, okay, we're capturing it. Okay. We're not so fixated in the details early on, am I correct?
Not really. I mean, I'm trying to get the mood first. We even have some clouds here if we want.
How long do you give yourself to capture the moon? Like, how long is too long?
Personal works. I think I'm much slower these days, so I think a week.
Just for capturing the moon?
No. I think capturing the moon is. I think a good 4 hours, 5 hours. I come back to it multiple times a day.
Oh, okay. Not in one go. Okay.
Yeah, not in one go. You know, these days I'd like to take my time. I'm really slow these days. I mean, I'm not as fast as I used to be. Yeah. Here's the clouds. Yes, I love the clouds.
Not as fast as you used to be. I remember you mentioning some numbers when you were interviewed by Kabuki Cat, DJ Lompanyo, and Red. Nowadays, what are your numbers? Like you mentioned like around a week before. How was that different before?
I mean, I really know to myself that I'm not really that fast anymore. Because, you know, I get tired and I don't like pushing myself too hard these days because I get really tired, and when doing personal work, I'm supposed to enjoy it, not feel like it's a chore.
Uh-huh.
So yeah.
That's a great topic because you have freelance work, right? For some of our artists here, some of them have day jobs as well. Mm-hmm. And then when they're done working, they feel tired when they get home. And some of them push themselves to work hard. How about you? How long do you give yourself in a day? In an average day, how long do you paint for personal art?
Usually a whole day. Like, I give myself a whole day when painting personal art. Like, when I'm finished commission, I have this day. Oh, today is a day for personal work and not commission. I don't do any commission work on that day and just work on something personal.
Oh, okay. So you have dedicated days. Are these like weekends or depends?
Depends, actually.
Ah, okay. You'd rather give yourself a whole day than just do like quickies, like 3 hours or something.
Yeah.
True. All right. There you have it, guys. Some of them are asking different techniques. So they want to, the biggest enemy for people working with day jobs is the energy gap.
Yeah, actually. So here, since I think I'm okay with the clouds now.
Oh. And that's still rough for you. Or...
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm not trying to detail it since I think we're going to turn this into night. Huh?
Yeah. So, we can go. Up to you. Which one do you want to go with?
So here in the night, I think the first thing I'll do is, since we already had the cool tone of the shadows and everything, I think we'll go with the color dodge. We add lighting on the buildings. Oops, wrong brush.
It's color dodge time.
Yes, either color dodge, actually whichever works for you. And look at that. Already made a difference. Something below, and maybe on this building as well. Oh, beautiful. It's like the... Oops, these are just two buildings. Oh, they're just two. It's even cut, you know. It's not seen, so why would I effort on that?
Is that true?
Okay, let's add more something like here. So it's, you know, just sometimes a small detail matters. You know, like something here. Okay, so that's our first contestant. And here's the next layer. Here we go with the same color dodge. These buildings, maybe. Mm-hmm. Where are they? Oops. Too much. I don't think light should hit that. Okay, see, maybe this part is somewhat tilted. Okay, jump off. Maybe this one too. Oh, this helps actually. Putting lighting here actually helps, you know, separate the character. Well,
okay.
Helps. But it, later on, we'll separate him more. We're just trying to add the lighting to save this sad drawing that I didn't. Okay, so maybe there and here. Okay. I think this one shouldn't have so much lighting though. Because of the tall buildings, I just realized this is a really low light na pala. Like the sun isn't seen here, so most lights here won't even hit the smaller buildings. But we'll still try to illuminate them later. Oh, this one's. Oh, this one here. It's color dodge. Maybe this side still gets some light, you know. But let's make the softer there. Maybe here. Just the roof. What part is this? Okay. I think even this house, just some partial light. Since the sun is very low at this point, I feel like the sun is very low at this point. Oh, That's the only part. So there's no light heating here anymore. This is like 6 p.m. Okay.
Okay.
Because the sun is so low. I realized it's very low right now. So here, I think only a few, only very few will hit this. Will hit this part. So maybe... Oops. So maybe it still hits him, you know.
The bat's coming to life. That golden glow, golden arm.
Yeah, we did it. Okay. So it's still not final though, because you know the values is all over the place. We should separate it like something more like this.
Uh-huh.
It's separately since we haven't added the, you know, the term atmospheric perspective.
Perspective, yeah.
So we're adding that next. So
okay. Here's the...
Oh, we still have these back buildings. So let's start all dodge like maybe random. Bumps here. Since they're at the very back. So yeah, we add something right there. I'm working from far, so I don't focus much on details. So
oh.
I don't really zoom in much. But usually I really zoom in like when I have lots of time. But what I'm trying to show here is how I work it. So you know the process of doing it. So now that we have that mood, it's at the, I use the layer lighten, so it only affects the dark ones, the dark colors, to create a spark perspective. Like I take a color from here, like maybe an orange, and you know, to separate the farthest buildings, but not. It, you adjust that depending how far those objects will be. And lighten again for the building. Yeah, so we got him to separate here.
Okay.
Right now, let's adjust it a bit. I want it to be more like yellow-orange. Okay. And more there. I like that. Maybe some of the sky as well, you know, some of the fog. Here we use lighten again, get some orange, separate this. Oh, I like that. Look how this history got separated even more.
More depth now.
Yeah, we created more depth. And this one, okay, let's just add maybe just a dark orange since it's not really there. Create some separation. Took some yellow. That's better. And the overall here. Oh, this one. I'll just lighten again. And oops, that's a bit too light. Yeah. There. And maybe some of blue as well. Yeah. And for the last one, lighten. I'll use some bit of a darker blue for here. And some bit of darker orange. Oops, that's a bit too red. It's just more yellow.
How are you choosing the colors? Is this from your experience, from all your observation when you commute?
Oh, I think more on experience and technique. Like when you have a warm highlight, you can tend to pick a cool tone shadow. When you have a warm shadow, you have, you know, some how color behaves, but sometimes you can also break the rules. Like for me, for atmospheric perspective, I like to use the more dominant tone, which is the warm tone, or whichever somewhat feels right to me. So I use the warmer orange here and a bit of blue as well on some parts. What interests me is the values. How it created the separation.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
And I think the last part I'll do is overlay or soft light. Okay, maybe overlay. Okay. For the chef kiss sunset.
Look at that.
I even add more light in here. Some light in here, so we have some blue. Oops, that's too light. It's 10%. Give me 10. Oops, that's still light. So it's not so strong. And even light, so you know the bloom of everything.
Uh-huh.
Even some cool tone here. Yeah. So yeah, it's overlay. So yeah, I think we made that. We made the sunset on the west.
Right. In just a few minutes, subscribers, you see that.
So yeah, from this rainy scene, we finally got the sunset.
From the sunset, are we going? Oh, there we go. From the rain to sunset. Are we going to nighttime right after this?
Oh, I mean, is there something else? Some topic you'd like, maybe you guys have other topics would you'd like me to talk about, or do you like seeing me show how I do stuff lang?
Oh, I'm pretty sure the subscribers love hearing more about your process, and some of them are really interested, especially with mood and setting. I've already asked a few questions. I have one more question in the end to end it off, but We can a lot more time for demos. I think subscribers would love that. I think some of them wanted to see how you made a night scene.
Okay, so a night scene. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So night scene it is. Are you guys ready for this? Because I'm not.
Oh, no.
Okay. Okay. So in a way we will reset everything. The nighttime is a bit trickier to do, but it's still fun, I guess. Cause you know, there are more lighting involved.
Oh, like artificial lighting?
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, let's do that.
I saw a couple of them ask specifically about the night scene.
Okay. So, one thing I noticed about the night is the sky is not black. Okay. It's not black, actually. It's actually lighter than we most thought. It's more on sometime purplish or blue. Okay, mm-hmm. It's something like this. Actually, it's something like this. Even it's the sky, night sky isn't as dark as the closest shadow near us. It's even darker. Since we still even at nighttime, we still have to follow the rule of values, where the closest image still has the strongest contrast, black and white. And okay. The night sky isn't exactly near to us, so it shouldn't have the darkest contrast. So yeah, see, here's the sky. And what I noticed from the... I don't have a reference for this. Pero sige, let's try making from scratch na lang. What I've noticed from night sky is they have this glow. Since the light pollution...
Oh, okay.
The light pollution from our city is really like this. Yeah.
By the way, subscribers, this is the last time of the day demo for tonight's session. And... yeah.
Feel free to ask while we're doing it, but at least we're also engaging in a talk while
painting. We heard that, folks. If you have any more questions you would like to ask Aeonix.
So usually pag ganito, I adjust their levels na lang. Something like that. Yes, no. Yes, no. If you want to be sure, let's make this into layer mode so it doesn't. You can always adjust it later on. Okay. And one from here, levels. Okay. Back right here. Oops, but do we have a difference on this layer? This has a light on it, so we're gonna use color dodge. I think the lighting in MRT are slightly cooler. Somewhat cool, but not a saturated green. Oops, what's that?
Oh, nope. Someone's. She is asking, how did you learn the different times of day? Maybe, I think, how did you learn to paint the different times of day? Was it purely based on IRL photos, or did you also follow tutorials?
More on, I study pictures I took and also took reference from the art books I like and movies I like especially yung good thing you good thing you reminded me. I use reference no before like yung the night scenes in Kimi no Na wa or Your Name.
Taki-kun, yes.
Yes, I use those as reference then. Wait. So here's a light. If you can see, we can find the right lighting yet. So we use explore. Which right? No. Which is right? I think this one works best, I think. So we use normal again. And we take the color and we go back to color dodge. So, oh, there it is.
Mr. Zeus asks, when you do your paintings, do you always have a certain feeling or time of day you want to portray from the very start? Or do you just create it in an overcast setting first and then decide on the mood or setting after?
Oh, actually the mood is decided before I paint it. I'm only speaking for personal works. Usually when I paint personal works, I usually decide on the mood first, like I want this to be nostalgic or maybe heavy or maybe something longing before. And the experimentation is also part of it. Like it goes with it as I paint. Like I also experiment on the way. Like I still adjust some final adjustments on the lighting, everything. So here, since there's light here, we know that some light do pass here. And even here, I think, I'm sure there's lights that pass here. Like the light from the MRT.
Oh, okay.
Like the cast shadow, I'm sure it cast shadow something here. Yeah. Okay. Okay, there's some light here. Doesn't have to be accurate, but you know. Yeah. I'm happy with that. I'm happy with this part only. It looks nice. It's missing a few bloom. Like, let's add maybe soft light. Let's add soft light. Oh, that's nicer. That's even nicer. I think let's just lessen this one a bit. So, oh, that's perfect. Perfect. Okay. Okay, so should we clip this? Clip or not? I need clip. Okay, now that we're done there, let's adjust the values. This one, let's levels. It's a bit dark. Oh, this one. levels. I want this to be dark as well. Okay, since these are roofs, I'd like to imagine that maybe there are some lights trying to peep through here, like from street lights. So they're usually warm orange. So let's imagine it like that. So there's some warm orange lighting coming from here, or in this part to the back of the house. There's color dodge. Add some street lights. You know, there's street lights everywhere. There's a post here. Maybe we could add a light there. It's not working. Why? That's not bright enough. Okay, let's add a light there. And maybe let's add a few red lightings. Since we already had this light here, we're gonna add a blue. That's a color dodge game. And make this the star shape. Ah, no, that's ugly. No. Anyway, let's just manually do it. Ah, okay, that's better. Let's add here. You know, the lights from the streets. I mean, this is the fun part of painting the night, you know, get to play with artificial lights. Oh, that's nice.
Oh, okay. Very ominous. Oh, I have a question from Pawi right here. She asks, actually, how does he deal with the commission's workload? Sa backgrounds, does he focus on one or does he have limits? By limits, I think she meant that the limit for commission is one artwork or two per week. Is it one artwork or two per week? Like, how do you manage your energy without burning out?
Oh,
for backgrounds, yeah. I think when you paint them from scratch.
Oh, for commissions. Oh. I do them while crying.
I mean,
it's really hard. I mean, since it's paid, that's my motivation. The money they paid me, I have to draw it since they paid for it. But, you know, you could still do it, but it takes a lot more discipline. Since I have to be professional when working on commissions, like I have, although. To manage it, I manage, like, I only take, like, maybe one to two full commissions per month. Because full commissions, like, full-blown background drawings really take a lot of energy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most important is you also communicate with your client. You are very... clear about them, like you also explain your situation. You have to be honest with them so there's no mishaps. You really need to communicate with them. You don't ghost them, so they don't worry, because I'm sure if you explain it well, they will understand naman, as long you explain it well, ganon. So yeah, you have to know yourself, and like you only take certain limits on what you can do per month to avoid the burnout. Because I tried it before and it's not good. It's not good for the health and for the mind and hands and everything. Like I used to take like 15 full commissions in a month.
Jesus Christ. 15?
Yes, but to be fair, that was the pandemic. To be fair, that was the pandemic. Like, I didn't have a choice. So yeah.
Is that how you? So that's how you protect yourself from burning out. You limit yourself to 1 to 2 photo sessions a month.
Yes, in a way.
So you set not really boundaries, but you let
set your limits.
Set limits, yes. Mm-hmm. With your clients, and there we go. Like, communication.
If you're full, you tell your clients you're not open this month. If you can do it, can contact you again next month.
Okay. Where do you? Some of them might wonder, like, where do you get clients? How do you get commissions? Like, are there any avenues? Because some of them want to start doing commissions as well.
Oh, actually, the trickiest part, in my personal experience, of commissions is finding where your clients are. Like, you gotta find your niche. Like, for me, it's the F14 community and the VTuber community. Like, once you tap one of them, like, once one knew your art, it's like a web. Like, since it was a community, many people would see more of your art. Like, more people will see your art in that community, and there's more likely a chance that those same people from the same community will commission you.
So you...
Yeah, I found my own Twitter.
Uh-huh.
And it started with one FF14 client that also became a friend, recently meet in real life, which is great. So yeah, it started from her, and I posted it like FF14, and I think the community liked my art, so it started there, and people have been commissioning me since then. You really have, like I said before, you really have to put yourself out there and let people see you, because you'll never know which community or niche will get attracted by your art. Like, maybe the VTuber community, the D&D community. I think I've heard even Reddit, you could also find clients on Reddit, though I haven't personally tried it.
Oh, okay. Oh, sound check. Some of them are asking, like, if they can hear the sounds. I think there are just some pauses. So far, I hear the sound.
Sound of what?
In general, like our voices. There, some of the audience people are asking, like, if the sound is cutting. So there we go. I think there are just some pauses in between. So okay, yeah, some of them mentioned that the audio wasn't cut. Oh, okay. In relation to that, and putting yourself out there, you mentioned before that you used to take advantage of trends or hashtags when they were still hot. However, there has been a recent shift lately in Twitter or X. Some have done an exodus. Some of them have left Twitter. And the hashtag is different now.
Yeah, so, actually, I'm not updated with that anymore.
Uh-huh.
Like before, I used to say that there are popular art trends you could join on Twitter that could help you let people see your art more. Like the art, the face your art, art versus artist, portfolio day. Like those RPH, like those were the good hashtags on the good days, the good old days. But I'm not really sure anymore. So,
okay.
I mean, honestly, I've really seen people complain about the algorithm, and I'm honestly unsure. I'm sure as well these days, because I haven't been active with my social as well.
So with your clientele right now, these are the old ones. I won't say old ones.
Usually, when you take care of your clients, they really return to ask for more of your art. Because when you make good connections, you make good clients. Like, they really come back for your art and support you. So it's really important to keep up a good communication as well with your clients. And not just, and good art and good communication is a good combo. Oh, if you see here, I'm trying to darken the topmost part since that's the part where it's not hit mob by the lights from below. So I'm trying to darken it to separate it from the night sky. See?
Oh, cool.
So it has that effect. So since we're done with that, I'm just gonna lighten everything so it sets it apart from this foreground, from our main foreground, which is the character and the MRT. So I'm just gonna create a lighten mode and add maybe a warm one there to separate it. Like there's light pollution here. No, just adds the mood, you know, and separates everything from the main subject. And here we also add, usually I make the lighting of the buildings, like we also add the lighting of buildings. Lastly, like I add, the brush. I usually add randoms. Or there's many ways to could do the lighting buildings. Like sometimes you could make this and lock that, add more some random colors. Then erase. And oops, I didn't like that color, so change that a bit more. Ah, I like this. No, I like the green one better. So this is what I'm telling the experimentation. So you go switch from something you don't like and what you like. I duplicate that. Merge. Duplicate that again. Merge. Duplicate that again. Something. Oh no. I'm rich. Okay. Something also should be smaller here. And add more here. And we mask that. And we just take away what we don't like. Like, not everything is lighted all the time.
Cool.
Something like that. Okay. See that effect? It has that effect.
Yeah. That's just in normal mode. Cool. Normal blending mode, by the way. Cool.
Yeah. I'll say we erase that as well. So, duplicate this. So, I think we could turn that to lighten anywhere, but it doesn't make a difference, I guess. So, we could also lock that layer and add more colors if you like. Like there's something, sometimes there's something more orange, more yellow, more green. It really depends on your taste. Oh, I forgot to add a red light here. Yeah. Also add some here. If you want that, you know, the red light feels something more, something here.
The helipads.
Okay. Let's add more lights here. Like you could say do the other method. Like maybe there's some little lights here or something here far away. Same stuff like I did here. Duplicate, then erase, and add here. I'm just doing it fast forward here. But you could always do that same technique I did there. Some light here. I want it here. I want some life here, light. Yeah. It adds life. And even in the night sky, there's also clouds. If you notice, there's also clouds in the night sky, so we are adding clouds. They're much darker than the night sky. There's a cloud. So we add that. Adding the clouds. And some even clouds get a bit more gray. You're like, that's all, oh, looks too gray though. Okay. And some even get a bit lighter when it gets closer to the to the city. Okay. Oh, and lastly, I forgot the stars. I forgot. How could we forget the stars? Oh, and I drew that on the background there. Nice. Nice.
Oh no, different layer. It's the wrong layer. No, going back.
It's going back now, I guess. So usually how I make the star is I usually take a blue one. Okay. Here, a blue one like that. And we add the light. Okay. I think that's believable. Okay. And I usually just duplicate that. Alt. Yeah. We create a few big stars. Okay. Oh, that's too big, I think. Ah, there. We create and just duplicate everything in random spots. Some stars get too close to each other. Some are clusters. We could even get close and some even super close clusters to each other like this. There. Then are those everything? Since we have that, could minimize this. There. Duplicate. We could even flip horizontal, something like this to create a non-repeating pattern. And here, duplicate, and here.
Quick hacks right there.
And
just a few seconds, we have a sky full of stars.
And I just minimize the lights. Yeah. I minimize the brightness. Yeah. So now we have the night sky. And for the final touch up, I guess it's the more on bloom of this foreground. So we get overlay, we get the color of the light, and we add more bloom here, coming from here. Because you know, so light gets strong here. Okay.
Finish!
Then up if I'm finally happy with everything, I just duplicate and merge, then add the chromatic aberration red. So yeah, add that. Then filter noise, add noise. And there we have our night scene. There. From sunset, you made a night scene. Okay, then here we have it. We now have a night. I didn't save the rainy scene, Omim. But we still have this, the old one. And the sunset.
And there we have it. In just a few minutes. God, he was able to change the time of the day.
That's why it's important to preserve your layers. So you can always play with them and play with the lighting and everything.
Sheesh. What a way to cap it off. And just to wrap it up, I have one more question. Let's say you're coming from that night scene. That's you right there. You go to bed. And just like in Your Name, you wake up in a different body. But you're not in a woman's body. No, you're in you're in 15-year-old Aeonix's body before college. Is there anything you would do different, knowing what you know now?
na
nothing. Enough said.
Nah, I mean, I think I mean personally, I think I already found my core since I really enjoy painting Philippines in nostalgic settings. I don't think I'll get tired of it my entire life, you know. I'll be painting other stuff as well. But, you know, for me, what I call home in art is painting backgrounds like this. It always makes me happy, you know. And at the same time, I'm learning when I'm doing it. Like, I'm learning how to paint buildings, perspective, etc. Moods. It's everything, actually. Like, even anatomy, because sometimes I paint people in with it. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so personally, I think this is already my what do you call it again? My ikigai.
Your ikigai. Oh, yeah. Your purpose in life.
Yeah, ikigai.
Oh, that's nice, and that is a perfect way to cap it off. Thank you so much, Mr. Aeonix.
I'm sure
everyone's clapping. I'll clap with you guys.
All right. No, thank you for being with me tonight. I hope the techniques I shared will help you guys. You know, drawing's already hard, and hope the techniques I shared will help you guys to express yourselves. Then, ganon. So it's expressing yourself is always a nice feeling, you know. Everyone should feel it, di ba?
Amen.
When you're able to express what's inside your head, ganon. So yeah, hope these things will help you express what you'd like to express from your head or your heart. Wow.
What a way. Another bomb dropped right there. Before he drops another bomb, Mr. Aeonix, in front of this camera, I know our cameras are off, but this camera, look here. Is there anything you want to promote? Where can the audience find you? Socials? Usernames?
Usually, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter pa rin. I still post there, although I'm a bit inactive these days, but I'm still alive. I mean, I still have a lot more to paint, and I still have a lot more. I still want to share a lot more to you guys, especially the manga of my characters, and also the current series I'm going on, which is the Escape Plan. It's actually, I made that series so I could paint more clouds this year. And hopefully it puts me in a momentum to keep going. You know, because I already started one, might as well do the whole 12 series.
Wow, we'll be looking forward to that. I'm pretty sure subscribers here as well will be looking forward to that.
Oh.
And with that, we end our second ever interview. Quick announcement to our subscribers right after this interview. Aeonix's art rewards and files will be posted by DJ Lumpia here on Discord because they're still fixing something on the website. So look forward to that. Once again, Mr. Aeonix, thank you. Thank you so much for sharing.
No, thank you. Thank you. It feels good to share to other art, especially to other artists. So thank you for having me here then. Thank you to you, Justin, and also for DJ Lumpia for having me here. Of course, thank you for everyone here.